Hi, everybody. First of all, let me introduce who we are and what we do. We are doing custom software development since 2008. We specialize in very sophisticated areas like high-performance networking and databases. We are one of the top contributors into MariaDB server, and also we are proud of development of positive technologies application delivery controller, the web application firewall mentioned in the Gartner Magic Quadrant. When we started to work on the positive technologies application firewall, we also started to work on our own platform to develop high-performance HTTP filters for such kind of project, and this is what Tempesta FW is. Actually, this is application delivery controller, and application delivery controllers are basically advanced HTTP accelerators, which also emphasize security, like DDoS protection, web application security, and so on. During the talk, I will be focusing on several mechanisms of web accelerators. In particular, in this picture, let's consider a simple case. We have a HTTP accelerator as a proxy. We have clients which speak on different HTTP protocols, and we have a bunch of upstream servers. The larger server means a faster server. So first of all, proxy must load balance requests among the servers, and the faster server should get more requests. Also, if one of the servers fails, then proxy should redistribute the HTTP requests among the rest of the servers. Also, since upstream servers usually speak on only on one HTTP protocol version, the proxy must convert different HTTP versions to the version which is applicable for upstream servers. Also, there are tedious termination, and usually web accelerators use cache to reply from the cached responses. During the talk, I want to make a disclaimer that I made my best to not to compare web accelerators directly. And when I speak that some of the servers has some feature, doesn't mean that all of them don't have the feature. Some of the implementations are more familiar for me, some are less familiar. So let's start from connections management. And the first topic in connection management, the first question is how many connections we should manage to the upstream server. The naive approach is to establish a new upstream connection for each English HTTP request. However, most of the modern HTTP proxies are able to keep live connections to with upstream servers. However, there is a rule of thumb that if you have 1,000 backend connections established by proxy, it means that you can you have a limited capacity of processed ingress HTTP requests as 1,000. This might be a problem during DDoS attack or large flash crowds. So HTTP 1 introduced message pipelining. It means that each connection can have several HTTP requests on the fly. However, the server must reply to the requests in order. HTTP pipelining significantly improves performance of the upstream connection. However, it's relatively hard to implement properly, and there are possible security issues which comes from the complexity of the implementation. At the moment, I know only three implementations are able to do HTTP 1 pipelining. It's a script, Tempesta, and Polypa. For example, as an example of security issue with pipelining, we can consider HTTP response splitting attack. In this case, clients firstly send us request with encoded HTTP response in its URI, in particular as a length attribute. Right after the first request, the client immediately sends another request with a URL which he or she wants to inject into the web cache. If proxy isn't able to decode URL properly, then it just sends both the requests to the upstream server. Now upstream server is vulnerable, and it must reply with a location header, and the location header must be exactly as URI. And since the server is vulnerable and just uses lang attribute assis, it just places the string assis and sends a response for the first request to the proxy. And since the client placed actually response for in the URI for lang attribute, proxy actually decodes the first response as two responses because the CLF checks splitting between the response. And here we go. For the first request, like lang equal foobar proxy, proxy cache uses a redirect, and also for the actual second request sent from the client, proxy injects the value of Shazam. The interesting point about this type of attack is that HP2 isn't vulnerable by such kind of attack because HP2 works on binary message framing. There is no CLF separator, and also it controls user stream identifiers to identify requests and responses. Thanks to the stream identifications, HP2 proxies can reply, HP servers can reply with different order. It means that if the first request came from the client is related with slow, then the server doesn't need to wait to reply in order. Instead, it can reply for the second or the last request first, and after that, send the response to the first request. So we don't need to keep request and response in order, and this also improves performance of backend connections. So if you use a CDN and you have a relatively is a relatively slow dynamic logic, for example, with a slow database access, or probably you just have a long round trip to CDN node, then typically you benefit from HP2 enabled to your CDN node. Also, HP2 provides some compression. It improves network throughput. However, it also makes CPU it's more CPU resources than HP1. Also, the drawback for HP2 is that since it uses encodings and compressions, several zero copy techniques aren't applicable for HP2. If we talk about HP pipelines, then we should mention independent and non-independent requests. Non-independent requests are requests which change the state of the server. Usually it's post request, while get, head, trace, and options are considered safe and independent requests. However, you can program your backend logic in such way that you make some changes on the server side using the get request. This is your responsibility. How do you manage this? We later will talk about the cache, and this also thinks about the web cache. In most of the cases, you cannot resend non-independent requests if connection fails and response isn't received for request. However, in HP2, you actually can resend non-independent requests. Settings in HP servers whether to send stolen requests and retry requests. For example, if you have a buggy server logic, then there could be requests which writes the buggy logic on your server, and once the server receives the request, it caches. If a proxy retries request to next available server, then the next server also caches, and so on. So if proxy just resends request, then we can quickly crash the whole cluster. So all the proxies have limits for time and the number of retries to retry requests. Consider a picture and example how we manage the connection logic. On the top picture, we see three clients with different requests. The larger red square is non-dependent requests, and all the requests are passed through load balancing logic and arranged to two server queues. And non-dependent requests are scheduled just as normal requests in the queue. However, non-dependent request is only always the last request which can be on the fly to the server. If the server connection fails, then we should resend all the responses requests to the first connection. Here we have limit size for only five requests in the queue. So we have to throw the last blue request from the first connection, and also we cannot resend the non-dependent request in HP one. To keep the messages ordering message response in order for client responses, we place error messages for the blue request and the non-important request in the normal queue for transmission. And when the request before the error messages when we have a response for messages before the responses, then we can send actual responses to client, and after that, the error messages. Most of the proxies buffer responses. This is a straightforward technique and the most reliable. So if you have a large HP response from your backend and you send it to the proxy typically just assembles the whole response in firstly in RAM, and after that it's not fit RAM, it starts to cache the content on the disk. So performance isn't good for large responses. However, if the proxy fully assembles response and replies with status code in response to the client, it means that the clients will typically receive the whole response. As opposite, proxy servers like Varnish or Tangent can send parts of HP responses as they come to the proxy. And it means that the proxy doesn't need to work with the disk and doesn't need so many RAM. However, if the proxy replies with 200 code, it doesn't mean that it's actually able to send the whole response to the client. For example, if during the transmission the upstream fails, then proxy just has to terminate the transmission. This also differences between HP prioritization in different HP servers. For example, we have two streams with priority 12 and 4. The naive approach is to send frames for stream A until we have a weight of 4 equal to B. And after that, we start to mix one request A, one request, one frame from B. So we have a spikes of from the A stream. This is a naive and a very efficient way to send to transmit frames. I mean, efficient in terms of CPU usage on the proxy. However, it's not fair, and H2O and NGHTP2 are able to properly arrange streams. In this case, send B frames for each three A frames. However, the algorithm is properly implemented in NGHTP2, and it requires a logarithmic time. In H2, is used optimized version. It's not so fair, it's not so accurate, but it's approximated and works in constant time. In Tempest FW, we work in kernel, and we use the kernel circuit buffers, which works with message fragmentation. This helps us to avoid copies. For example, if we consider that this HP request and we need to adjust X404. In our case, we just cut the HP message and rearrange frames to actually place the inserted data after the actual data. And the network adapter will be able to arrange the frames on its own. So in this way, we avoid copies and can adjust message in more efficient way. This no application layer HP service, which are able to do zero copies. Speaking about HP parsers, there are three types of parser. The first one is so-called multi-pass HP parser. This example from Varnish HP parser. Consider that we have to match HPS in received HP request. In this case, we first match the string against HP scheme, and after that, we match it against for HPS. This is not so efficient. Nginx and several other servers use more efficient state machine. It's usually encoded as a couple of switch statements in the loop. So we start from the first state and the character B. We find our state and appropriate alphabet character. Next, we jump to the end of the statement. We start from the next state, and now we only now we can jump to our required state. So if we look closer to what's happened in the parser, we see that the parser just pins loops just to reach the next state. However, in a more clever way, we can just fall through to the next state. And this is what Tempest parser does, and other parser generators like Regel also do. The first naive approach with multi-pass parsers are used in Varnish and HAProxy. Nginx and Apache Traffic Server uses a switch statement. In Tempest FW, H2O, and Cloudflare, which is actually a patched version of Nginx, uses single instruction multiple data parsers, which works much faster. I have a separate talk in Scale about high performance HP parsers, where I describe the details of the efficient parsers. Why HP parsers are efficient? On the left side, we see example from Booking.com. If you select just a bunch of properties for a hotel, and on the right side, we see a real life example for Nginx. This is not the whole state machine for parsing URI, and real Nginx has much heavier code in this place. And surely we it's quite long to run the whole code for the long queries. And also, if we consider DDoS attacks, that attacker may send us a lot of data in any HP field. And also, we have to, in the case of Tempest FW, we want to filter out injection attacks. So we not only need to match query against the normal HTTP RFC, but also we need to execute additional security logic to find the SQL injection and other types of injections. To look at on the example, we can use a Varnish traffic generator with all the URI as above and real life HTTP headers took from Firefox browser and use the benchmark against Nginx. We quickly see that Nginx parser is on the top of the pair of profiles. So high performance links are actually a matter for high performance HTTP proxies. The next topic is encoders and decoders in HTTP2 and HTTP3 protocols. The thing is that they use Huffman encoding. Huffman encoding encoders all the bytes into several bits. Sometimes they are less than 8 bits, sometimes larger. However, since the decoder works in sub-byte ranges, we cannot use single instruction multiple data. So it's quite hard to make efficient Huffman encoder and decoder. The next stuff is that HTTP2 parsers are very memory hungry. Consider that we, first of all, the dynamic table is limited size, and it works in the following way. When HTTP parser meets HTTP header first time, it assigns some index for the header, and all the following requests with the same header will just use the same index for this header. Now consider that we have, for example, a dynamic table of 4 kilobytes, and the client send us a very large, for example, cookie of 4 kilobytes. And now the proxy assigns some identifier to the cookie, and the client after that can send us, for example, 100 cookie indexes of the same cookie and send us 100 such requests. So we have a multiplication of 4 kilobytes for 100 and 100. This actually HPAC bomb. At the moment, most of the servers use HP limits for such kind of bomb, but this still rule of thumb that HTTP2 is quite memory hungry and cannot work as efficiently as HTTP1 parsers. The also bad thing about HTTP2 is that while it's mostly binary protocol, it also leaves fully string representation as a compatibility. So we do have to still support parser for plain strings. Also, Cloudflare had measures about how HPAC works, and it does make sense only for requests. For responses, while the most of the data is for message body, this not so much sense to encode response headers, and only 1% of improvements was observed. Also, there are history about HTTP2 in most of the servers. Why H2O was developed as solely HTTP2 server. Also in Tempesta FW, we first supported HTTP1, but we fully rewrote our HTTP logic to support HTTP2. Most of modern HTTP accelerators were first written for HTTP1. So we sometimes we find in source code that the servers still continue to work internally with HTTP1 strings and use HTTP2 only as a plugin for HTTP1 transformations. There are many ways how to control caching in web cache. There are cache control and pragma important directives in HP requests. So if you use some dynamic logic for GET requests, and actually the logic is intrusive, for example, you make some actions on the logic, it means that you have to use cache control to no cache such content. Otherwise, the core proxy can consider such, such requests as independent and will cache the results. Usually, we do not cache POST requests and non-patent requests. However, the interesting point which I want to cover in this presentation is whether we should cache set cookie. After all, set cookie sometimes contains security sensitive identifications, and usually it doesn't doesn't make sense to cache such kind of content. However, RFC does allow to cache responses with set cookie. However, if your set cookie is security sensitive, you have to use no cache HP directives to make the proxy not to cache such responses. This is a difference between what the, most of the proxies do by default. Varnish and Nginx Apache Traffic Server do not cache responses with set cookie by default. Tempesta FW, Apache mod cache script do cache such responses. This a real life example from eBay. Why people need to cache POST requests. In their case, in eBay, they had so many features that they couldn't fit URL for GET requests. The problem was that intermediary proxies just cut off such requests. So they had to use POST to be able to send more more properties of requests to backend server. So they had to to cache POST requests. And actually you can cache POST requests. However, you need to invalidate your URIs. HP proxies have to deal with the freshness of HP responses. It means that there are several HP headers which control until which time and during which time the HP response is considered as fresh and should be sent to clients. However, in some cases, for example, if a backend server isn't available, or probably we face a DDoS attack and we don't want to overload our upstream server, sometimes it makes sense to serve POST requests and stale web cache to the client. So most of the proxies have control directives to be able to serve stale and non-fresh content from the cache. The interesting point about the server push for the proxy. While HP server understand what it can push and the data dependency, the data dependency isn't clear for proxy. So there are several features which allow proxies to use HP2 server push. The first example is to learn which resources a server pushes for particular HP requests. So Apache HPD is able to track the diary of the resources pushed by the server and push them for corresponding HP requests. H2 uses cookies to track which what's the state of the client for cached content. This also link header and HPM early hints, which work in following way. This very important. This works for HPM one backend server. So even with HPM one backend server, we still can use HP2 server push from a proxy. For example, on this picture, we send a GET request to example com for index page, and the server realizes that it needs some time to process some application logic. So it sends HP response early hint and places a link header. So now the proxy sees the response and sees the link, and this way, HP proxy can send HP push with the style CSS to the client. And that might happen that the client will receive style CSS even before backend server forms response and sends it to proxy. The next topic is very header. The interesting point about vary header is that it's actually a second index. Consider that we have a separate content for different languages of our web resource. And while cache, web cache works on host header and URL, we still need to distinguish different languages for the same cache key by URI and host. And this is done by vary. Setting vary header in response, we may say to proxy server to use it as a secondary key, like a database secondary key, to store web content. Accept language is a good example of using query. User agent isn't. While you might consider to use the user agent to distinguish your content for mobile and desktop, it's still not a good example. Because every patch level, every version, new version of each browser produces a different user agent. And this means that you quickly overflow your web cache with too many versions of the same content for each patch level of web browser. The another example is accept encoding. There are about 40 different accept encodings. It's not so big and not so, so less. So in this case, we need to do some rewriting logic to normalize available accept encoding to particular encodings which make sense for your content. Also, if you want to use user agent as invariant, you also need to use some rewriting logic to normalize all user agents to only browser models, like for example, if you use Firefox on desktop or Firefox on mobile. So only two types of Firefox here. If we spoke about secondary index, then we mentioned databases. And actually several HP proxies like Apache Traffic Server and Tempest FW uses lightweight databases to speed up web content servicing. Nginx, Squid, Apache HPD uses file system web access. It uses file system directories, and surely it's not the fastest way to serve the web content. Varnish is very different in all the cases because it uses mapped storage. And there was a post from BBC about experience with using Varnish. And basically, a map-based storages aren't good for large hardware. In the case of BBC, they used very large RAM and even larger disks. So virtual memory management of Linux had to deal with plenty and plenty of pages. And it uses linked list and So the guys experienced significant performance degradations on large data sets. Next point about the section is request coalescing. Consider that HP proxy receives 100 HP requests to the same URL. The naive proxy will just forward all the requests to upstream server. Of course, if it doesn't have the resource in its cache. However, Varnish and Nginx and Tempesta FW also will support this in next version, able to coalesce all requests. So if the proxy sees that there are 100 requests to the same resource, it actually sends only one request to upstream server, suspends the rest of 99 requests, and when the response comes from the upstream, it sends it to all the 100 requests. The next topic is how the servers work with threading threads and network I/O. Varnish uses threads, Nginx uses process, and Tempesta is software queue. In this point, I want to mention that this pros and cons for threads and process model. First of all, Varnish need to allocate a separate operating system thread for each request. This performance cost, so they spent memory and also more pressure on the CPU schedule. However, there is no blocking for event, like if Nginx has only a limited number of processors, and if you process some slow HP requests, like for very large HP headers, then you cannot work on another HP request. Cloudflare reported this problem about Nginx, so Nginx doesn't suit for filtration logic, which usually makes the processing logic even heavier. Also, Meltdown mitigation has performance significantly. It's enabled by default on all modern Linux operating system. So if you use any of the application layer HP proxies on the edge, you actually work in single user environment and don't need the protection. So I suggest to recompile the kernel to disable page table isolation. Tempesta FW works in kernel and isn't affected by the problem at all. If we consider how network packets are arrived to network adapter, these three packets, software queue places the packets to appropriate socket queues and sends notification to application process. Now the process starts to read from the socket and survives the request from the cache. Typically, cache is relatively large data structures, and it evicts the rest of requests from the CPU cache. And when the server reads the last HP request from the socket, it finds it out of the cache. In Tempesta, we process all the data. It was a data-driven processing, and we process all the requests while they're still hot in CPU cache. The next thing is zero copy user space sockets. The only one server which uses is HAProxy. It works perfectly for large responses and large HP requests. However, it requires more system calls, so it's more sensitive to KPTI. Again, for Tempest FW, since we work in kernel space, there's no zero copies at all. In Tempesta, we use specific data structures to mitigate copies in user space and kernel space. And if you consider how the data comes from first circuit to user space buffer, next it must be transformed like add to additional HP request. And after that, it's again copied to the kernel space and probably sent from another CPU. In Tempesta, we use per CPU message queues. So we do all the work on the local CPU and the local TCP control buffer and assign work to a remote ring buffer for a remote CPU for transmission. I don't want to skip working. The last topic is TLS. Most of the proxy servers terminate TLS in their own context. Varnish is different in this group because Varnish uses separate process and the program Hitch. It's actually a separate TLS termination proxies. There also hardware acceleration. There are some patches for OpenCL, but it seems that no one open source HP proxy is able to use quick assist technology out of the box. This is another acceleration for KTLS, which allows you to not to copy data from kernel space to user space for encryption and after that copying back to the kernel for transmission. With Linux kernel TLS, you can encrypt the data right in the Linux kernel and send it to the client. There are OpenCL patches for using KTLS, but I'm not sure if they are already applied to the mainstream or not. Also, it seems that no one of open source proxies can use the acceleration. The last topic about TLS is TLS record size. The problem is that TLS works with 16 kilobytes record sizes, and the thing is that it places authentication header at the end of the record. So if we start a TCP connection, we start from a small congestion window, we can send only a small part of TLS record, and only when receiving part receives the data, it sends acknowledge to the sender, and sender can send the rest of TLS record. In this way, we spend two round trips just to start TLS decryption. Most of open source proxies have some heuristics how to form TLS records. However, they don't know about current state of TLS connection. In Tempesta, we encrypt traffic right before forming TCP transmission buffers. So we form TLS records of the same size of current congestion window. So I'm done. There are references to which can be used. Thank you. We'll be happy to see you on our GitHub for your tasks, comments, and so on. So thank you.